If you look at the size of the deficit, it's greater than the transfer payments from young productive to older retired people. We're not paying now for Social Security. We're billing our kids for it.
The Social Security Trust Fund is set to run out in 10 years or less, but there's a big variable missing from the calculation. My guest today is bioeconomist Patrick Cox, who believes we're on the cusp of major biological breakthroughs that could dramatically extend the healthy lifespan of every human being. Today, let's explore what that means for the economy, Social Security, and society. I'm Ed D'Agostino, and this is Global Macro Update. Patrick, you're a noted bioeconomist, and that's a term that I don't think everyone would be familiar with. So before we jump into, I want to get into Social Security, increasing health spans, what that means for people's wealth span. I want to get into all those things that you're so eloquent in discussing. But before we do that, I want to just kind of set the stage of where you're coming from. Can you explain kind of your background as a bioeconomist?
First, a macroeconomist. I've always been interested in the big picture, not specific sectors, not even particularly stock prices or industries or anything like that. I'm most interested in what moves the entire global economy. What are the big forces at work? Often because they're the most important. So if you look at, so just over the years, my focus has been increasingly on the genomic or biological aspect of economics, which overwhelms everything else. I mean, take, for example, the fact that for the last 200 years, lifespans have been increasing exponentially. So, you know, 1980, people were living, in 1800, lifespans were about 40 years long. That's on average. And then slowly over time, we've had this consistent increase in both lifespans, life expectancy, and health spans. And that has changed everything in terms of our social institutions, of our family structures, our economy. This all comes from biology. So the big impact of longer lifespans has been the reduction in birth rates. And we saw this, you know, even before World War II, everybody thinks about the baby boom as this event where we got this huge bulge in demography. But if you look at the birth rate, the fertility rate, it was already going consistently down. And then during World War II, it dropped farther and then rebounded to make up for that lost time, which explains why we got the snake, the bulge in the snake. And when it produced this overly influential generation, which is mine, we were the boomers who've gotten everything we want, including a doubling of all benefits. We were essentially, I probably shouldn't take any further. Offend people, but we've always got what we wanted. Unfortunately, along with these increases in benefits and transfer payments to the aged, what was going on was a reduction in the birth rate, the fertility rate. So, you know, when I was in college, the big deal was the overpopulation hysteria. So we had Paul Ehrlich's book, The Population Bomb, which had one version of the book had a picture of a baby with a fuse in its head. So and everybody started talking about birth control, talked about we need to reduce the birth rates. Practically unknown to anybody at the time is that in 1970, when his book, the 70-71, was published, the U.S. was already below replacement birth rate. 1970.
Wow.
And it's continued to And that's about 2.1 babies per mother. You know, obviously, if a woman has two children, is going to replace her, you know, her husband and herself. But, you know, and then there is some infant mortality and people die as they go along. So about 2.1 is what it takes to just replace. We've always had immigration, but that's not the big factor. Populations were increasing at the time, but they weren't increasing due to births. They were increasing due to the fact that people were taking longer to die. Population equals births minus deaths. So we had fewer deaths, the population was going up. So ironically, Ehrlich and everybody else at the time, and this was complete madness. I mean, everybody, the media, the UN, you know, everybody was talking about overpopulation is going to kill us all. I mean, Ehrlich was predicting that he predicted in the 1970s, by the 1990s, there would be, I think, 200 million people dead from starvation in Europe. Just nuts. I mean, none of it ever happened. But, you know, he succeeded in creating a movement. And interestingly, over the years, I mean, I've been saying this my whole life. I mean, as writing for USA Today, Wall Street Journal, everybody else that I wrote for, I've always been talking about this. And the reason was, I didn't go to an elite Ivy League school. I went to Boise State University, the land grant college, you know, that, and we were relying, I'll show you a copy of this book. This is Population Problems by Warren Thompson, written in 1930. This was the standard sociology population demographics book, widely used. And in it, he explains the demographic transition. What he said was that as people live longer and become wealthier, and those two things always happen hand in hand for chicken and egg reasons, that the birth rates fall. He only made one mistake. Well, he probably made others, but the big mistake he made, because he'd spent time in Japan, was he was convinced that the Japanese had such an affinity for large families that their birth rate would never go down. Now Japan is disappearing, essentially disappearing. So he was wrong. I mean, there's nothing you can do. And now we see this same reduction in birth rates everywhere, even including Angola, parts of Africa that have had traditionally enormously high birth rates. So we knew at the time, this wasn't this hysteria, overpopulation hysteria. You know, it just came out of the blue. It just reflected a profound ignorance of the existing scholarship. I mean, what Thompson looked at was, just the basic math of population growth. I mean, if you understand calculus, you understand derivatives, the rate of change, and the second derivative, how fast is that rate of change? Well, it was evident then that what we were heading for was a dramatic decrease in birth rates that would lead eventually to population decrease. And he graphed the whole thing at the time.
You fast forward to today, and here we are, right? Everything right. that he predicted is here, and it's not just in the U.S. It's in Europe. Right. It's in Japan, as you noted. It's even in China. What are the implications? Maybe in the U.S. and then globally to having this increasingly aging population?
It is the collapse of the dependency ratio. You know, we talk about there's the old age dependency ratio is looking at people between basically 20, 25 and 65 who are productive. That's not exactly accurate because a lot of people are working longer. Nobody willingly retires. We have, you know, people retire either because their companies don't want them on their insurance rolls, or their spouse is sick, or they want to manage their own funds, which kind of, you know, is representative of Mauldin Economics we use. But those people are working. Just because you're not going to an office doesn't mean that you aren't working. So essentially nobody voluntarily retires. The problem is that when we do retire, we depend on various institutions, not just Social Security, but our families, our pensions, all kinds of different resources to help us make it through our non-productive years. Well, when in 1950, the year before I was born, there were 33 contributors for every Social Security recipient. Today, it's less than 3 to 1. And theoretically, you know, people are saying, there are people who assert that anything over 3 to 1 is enough to keep Social Security liquid and functioning. I would submit that it's not functioning now. People talk about it failing in 10 years, but the fact is that if you look at the size of the deficit, it's greater than the transfer payments from young productive to older retired people. So we're not paying now the for Social Security. We're billing our kids for it. And the problem with that is that eventually, you know, that leads to some sort of a credit crisis. The CBO has written eloquently about this problem. You know, if you keep borrowing, eventually lenders lose faith in your ability to repay debt. And then the cost of borrowing goes up dramatically. And that's what we're facing. You know, if this keeps going, we will be unable to borrow our way out of this debt. And at that point, you know, we're looking at Greece as a best case scenario. We're looking at triage. We're looking at massive failure of government programs, healthcare, medical, you know, all of these medical programs. The money just doesn't exist, to pay for this increasingly larger retired population.
When you say Greece, you're talking sort of post-Great Financial Crisis Greece, where they had to enact a period of deep austerity to get their economy under control.
And they're still suffering from it. You know, mortality rates went up, both infant and elderly. Everybody who could left. So we're looking at that kind of scenario, but on a global basis. And it's really ugly. So, I mean, this is the irony, is we had all of these people warning about overpopulation, helped to create this problem by encouraging people not to have children, when what we need, in fact, is children in order to keep the economy strong. I mean, GDP is one factor in that formula is population. And if your population, especially if productive working people is falling, then your GDP will fall. So that's what we're looking at. We're looking at a major crisis. So, you know, I was fortunate to go to school where I had an Austrian bias. My mentors, my professors were, you know, incredibly well informed. So they started me thinking in terms of this sort of thing. So let's look historically. What has happened? What actually works? Well, it's biotechnology works. You know, we know it does because of the increase in lifespans. So if we're going to fix this problem, the only way to do it is on the health span side. Increase human capital by keeping people from getting sick and keeping them productive longer. You know, everybody has tried to increase birth rates. It hasn't worked. Nations have bribed. They've encouraged. It just doesn't seem to work. So the only thing that does work and has worked historically is biotechnologies that increase lifespan. Now, fortunately, due mostly to Moore's law and the arrival of computer technologies, the rate of scientific discovery has continued to increase exponentially. everybody knows this. They know it in terms of computer power, but they tend not to know that that also applies to the rate of scientific discovery. So what is true is that in the last 10 years, we have made more scientific progress than all previous history. And the same will be true for the next 10 years. So this exponential increase in scientific knowledge has led us to the position where we now understand the processes of aging well enough to reverse them. And we have reversed them in 8 different animal species at this point. Well, actually, yeah. And now there's 2 basic approaches to doing this, but we are very, very close to dramatic breakthroughs in not just anti-aging, but age reversal.
You think about what that means, though, right? So if people are living longer, and allegedly living healthier longer, so increasing their health span along with their lifespan, doesn't there need to be some sort of societal rearrangement, if you will? I mean, Macron tried to raise the retirement age in France by 2 years, and people started setting cars on fire.
Right.
I mean, and their age is already what, 62? I mean, it's low.
Yeah.
There's a huge disconnect here.
Yeah, it's crazy.
It's just medicine. People are going to need to take some medicine, and you might live to be 100 and be healthy, and you know, up until the end, and you're probably going to have to work the whole time. Is that what it's going to turn into?
It's almost certainly you'll have to work the whole time, but it's not just 100. I mean, this seems like science fiction, but you know, looking at the results that we've seen in animals, and now we have dogs for the first time. 100 is really a conservative estimate of what healthy lifespans will be. So this is a profound change. This is not just 1 or 2 decades. This is, we now have 2 telomerase inducers. Telomerase, the TERT gene, causes telomeres to grow at the end of chromosomes. And telomeres are the hard limit on your maximum lifespan. It's called the Hayflick limit, discovered at the Wistar Institute in Pennsylvania. And now one group of scientists at Johns Hopkins, probably the most prestigious research group in the world, has worked on a small molecule, which means it's synthesizable and relatively inexpensive, that dramatically increases telomere lengths. That means that your body's supply of stem cells to replace damaged and aged cells is infinite. And when that happened, people that I know said, this is obviously a scam. It can't happen. This is the singularity. If it's true, therefore it's not true. But then MD Anderson announced that they had used basically AI in silico experimentation, looked at over 600,000 molecules. They found a small molecule telomerase inducer, put it in animals, and the same thing happened that has happened to the animals using the Hopkins drug, which is radical increases in telomerase, age reversal in very old animals, taking them essentially back to peak middle age. That isn't even the most radical medicine. I mean, there's medicine on the horizon, so-called partial reprogramming or induced tissue regeneration that would regrow limbs, organs, would access your original embryonic program to repair all the damage that has accrued in your lifespan. It won't just keep you alive. It will make you as perfect in ways that you may never have been. And to, to give you an idea of how seriously people are taking this, both Altos Labs, which is the Bezos company, and Calico, which is the Google company, are now dedicated to this technology. At least $5 billion in capitalization has been provided. And there's at least seven other companies, including a new one by Mike West, who actually came up with this stuff. He's the original inventor. So a lot of people are working on this. I see three steps. Since we don't know when they're going to actually be available, the first one is to take advantage of the biotechnologies that work and are available now in order to increase your odds of making it to the point that you can access these much more radical biotechnologies. The second one, I think, is probably telomere extension. The third one is partial reprogramming. So, I can't do anything to accelerate the arrival of these radical life extension biotechnology, but I can do things right now to make myself healthier, to make other people's healthier. And that's what I've been doing for the last almost 4 years with Dr. Michael Roizen, who is, renowned expert in aging and the use of available medical technologies to keep people as healthy as possible so that you'll live younger longer.
It's funny you say that. I've known you for about a decade now. And I hadn't seen you in maybe 5 years, and I just saw you for John Mauldin's 75th birthday, his party in Puerto Rico, and I was kind of shocked. You look younger now than you did when I last saw you.
Like I feel younger.
Got striking.
I'm 73, and my lifts are still going up. I'm more flexible than I was 10 years ago. I can do things, gymnastic moves that I couldn't when I was 60. So we look at the big radical life extension breakthroughs. Those are, as I said earlier, I think they are the singularity, not the, the IT singularity that, the people talk about, but the singularity from John von Neumann, the scientist, Einstein's colleague, who came up with the concept that science is progressing so rapidly that we're looking at the inevitability that something will happen. And he didn't say what it was. He didn't say it was AI or even computer related. That would change society so radically that we couldn't really predict what things look like beyond that. It comes from math and physics, the concept of the singularity. So that's the big dramatic stuff. But there's also just really dramatic progress in less marginally effective, but still important biotechnologies. Some people call them biohacks. A lot of people hate the term. I don't care. I just know that there's a bunch of stuff that works. Bruce Ames, famous biologist who is kind of a hero to people in the policy world because he became the leading spokesman against using his Ames test, which looks for signs of tumorigenicity, cancer-producing effects in different drugs, which was then overused by bureaucrats who want to ban all the things. But he got out of that and went into nutritional research in his 70s and has identified what he calls anti-aging vitamins, or triage vitamins that we didn't know existed because they don't fit the old standard definition of what a vitamin is. And there's a bunch of other things, things you can do that will make your genome work better. It will make you functionally younger.
if you'd be so kind, just give me one of your favorites. And then what I want to do is I want to move into, you talked about telomere extension. I want to get into sort of how far out you think that is and what are the hurdles to making that available at the human level.
The first issue of our newsletter, the new newsletter with Chris Wood, I wrote about hydrogen therapy. So though we could talk about heat shock genes as well. I mean, the amount of real research supporting the use of saunas, hot baths, is extraordinary. You know, you can cut your risk of all-cause mortality by 40%, cancers, Alzheimer's, just by heat therapy. I really love this area, and there's a little, as I say, overwhelming research both from the Scandinavians because of the sauna, and the Japanese because of this Weon technology near infrared saunas. So there's a lot of stuff like that. And it's kind of frustrating that the medical establishment is so conservative, so resistant to change. I could go on.
And when you say sauna, like, are you talking about like you rent a ski house in Vermont and it's built in the 80s or the 70s and you go in the basement and there's this room with cedar all around it and it's a sauna, right?
Absolutely.
Like, is that what you're talking about?
Yeah, absolutely. That's the Scandinavian form. Russian form is the steam bath. The American Indian form are the smoke lodges, Japanese use Weon, but there's also, you know, you can actually use a hot bath. If you get up to about 110 degrees, it's probably superior to a sauna, because water is a better heat transfer, medium, and it removes the one danger that comes from saunas, which is overheating of the brain. So, I mean, if you're doing heat therapy properly, you want out after 10 minutes. You know, it becomes an effort of will to stay in a good sauna beyond 10 minutes, where 20, 25 minutes is probably optimal exposure. And the more often you do it, the better the results in terms of all-cause mortality, reduction in disease rates, that sort of thing.
I was going to say, who knew? But I guess the Scandinavians and the Japanese knew, and Americans knew.
But I've never had a doctor tell me that I should take hot baths or go to the sauna.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Not a Western doctor, at least, right?
Yeah. Maybe if I lived in Norway.
So I want to explore a little more what you said about telomere extension and just how, I mean, what if the technology that you mentioned from Johns Hopkins, if that makes it to human levels, well, first, how far away do you think it is, and what are the obstacles and what are the implications?
I think that we'll probably do phase one safety trials this year with the Hopkins drug. And I don't think it'll take, I don't have a direct connection to the MD Anderson people, though I'm working on it. That will come a little later. They've already done animals and they've done human cells. They obviously know what they have. So it will be commercialized. So we'll get phase one in humans. But we'll get a veterinary form very rapidly. As I say, they're testing in dogs, and the compassionate use uses of this drug in dying animals was dramatic. Full recoveries from cancer, osteoarthritis, seeing very old dogs return to, you know, almost puppies, you know, grown puppy status, dancing around.
How is that possible? Like, is your body literally healing itself? I mean, is it's consuming its own cancer?
When you get old and start to run out of telomeres, then your genome does not function correctly. And as a result of that, you start to develop senescent cells that are sending signals to the rest of the body that cause serious problems. And it just creates this milieu for chronic age-related disease. Now, when you're young, that doesn't happen because stem cells have partially activated telomerase, which grows telomeres, but it's not completely activated. So when you're young, if you have a car accident or a disease, even major tissue damage, then your stem cells will replace those damaged tissues so that your body can then repair itself. But as you get older, you run out of these stem cells and those repairs no longer take place. A lot of this still has to be confirmed, but I think the major impact of a telomerase inducer is basically giving us infinite stem cells. So, and one of the reasons I believe that is that if you look at both mice and dogs, if you look at how often their cells turn over, you get an initial increase in health, but you get a dramatic increase in health about the time that you're seeing cells roll over and into replication. And so in those cases, because of the unlimited stem cells, you're seeing, instead of old sick cells replicating, you're seeing new embryonic fresh stem cells replacing aged cells. And that is responsible for this rejuvenation effect.
What does that mean? Is it adding 20 years to people's lives? Is it immortality? Like what is the actual impact?
Well, biological immortality is a scientific term. It's not a spiritual term. It's not religious. It has nothing to do with superheroes or anything like that. But in animals, we're seeing biological immortality, which of course exists in nature. I mean, this is not new. I mean, if you look at planaria flatworms, if you look at Greenland sharks, if you look at the American lobster, the axolotl, Mexican salamander, the naked mole rat, all of these animals are non-aging. They are biologically immortal. They die, usually from predation or accidents, or sometimes because they get too big. Some animals continue to increase in size as long as they're alive. But we have immortal animals in nature. And so what we have seen with the use of these drugs is turning regular, wild, field mice who have been selectively bred to be good lab rats or lab mice being biologically immortal like the naked mole rat.
And healthy. And yeah, so you're like sort of like, wow, this is kind of mind blowing. if you're biologically immortal, is there a plateau, if you will, that you hit and then you sort of stay there age-wise? Like, do you get to the point where you're 40 or 45 and then you kind of stay there?
That's the theory. I mean, until we actually do it, we can't prove it. But that's the theory. And that appears to be what we're seeing in animals.
The Social Security Fund is completely screwed.
On the other hand, it will be unnecessary. There will be changes in the laws saying that, it's like reverse mortgages. Reverse mortgages often have a clause saying that if you live this long, contracts are null and void. They're taking into consideration that you could be a super ager or super centenarian, and they're not covering that. They're not going to continue to pay some sort of,
at some point you got to get out.
So, if we are in effect doing away with maximum lifespans, I mean, the first thing that will happen, given the fact, as we discussed earlier, that almost nobody actually retires voluntarily, is we'll see far less need for Medicare. People will be healthier. They won't need the, they won't have these medical expenses. There will be resistance to cutting off the benefits, but it will, but it has to happen. You know, we know that a continually shrinking population of young contributors cannot pay for the current population of old dependents. If that population of older people grows due to the arrival of telomerase inducers, then the whole thing essentially fails immediately. Though we won't need it. You know, I think there will be other mechanisms. You know, if you're a, you know, peak middle age, you know, I think most people are happier working.
So, like, just one more thought experiment. Could you become multi-generational? Meaning, would it be sort of common for adults to have two or three sets of children?
That's probably possible. It isn't guaranteed. I mean, you know, women are born with a certain number of eggs, and they tend to run out. It's not clear that telomerase induction will increase those eggs. Men basically will probably be able to fertilize indefinitely. But I think that, I mean, we're already seeing experiments in terms of creating ovum. So there will, I think that there will be technological fixes for people who do want to have more children, who are older. But, you know, how that actually works out is yet to be seen.
Patrick, we're going to have a link in the description below for anyone who's watching. You did a report on your favorite bioenhancements. And so we'll have a link to that in the description. And I'm really looking forward to your new product, your new service with Chris Wood, Transformative Age. It's always fascinating to speak with you. I really look forward to our next conversation.
Thank you, Ed. It's great to see you.
So if you want to hear more about this topic, you can get a free report from Patrick Cox. It's called Longevity Myths and Solutions, and you can find a link for it in the description below. Thanks for joining us.